Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Dr. Philip Phillips, and I'm the Associate Dean of the University Honors College. With us today is Dr. Kayleen Giebert, who worked alongside me in putting together this lecture series. So I'd like to take this moment again to express my gratitude to Dr. Giebert for helping me come up with the distinguished list of speakers for the series. Today, I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Thomas Jurkanin, who is Associate Professor of Criminal Justice here at MTSU. He earned his PhD at Southern Illinois University, and he specializes in police and society, police ethics, police leadership, and criminal theory. In addition to his academic credentials, he has more than 40 years' experience in the field of criminal justice. And he's graciously accepted our invitation to speak today and to share some of that experience with us. The topic of his talk is the current state of police and society. So please join me in welcoming our guest today.
Well, thank you for the invitation. I want to just talk a little bit about my background in more detail. I'm a little bit different, I guess, in terms of how I ended up at a university, because I spent my entire career at a state-level criminal justice policing agency in the state of Illinois. And I started as a staff person, worked my way up to become director of the agency at 35, and then was director for 17 years. I had earned my PhD when I was 28, so I always knew I wanted to teach and get back to teaching sometime, but I wanted to know when I did teach that I had the experience and, you know, to share. So I got into criminal justice, into policing, not by my own choosing. My father was a football coach, and he had a former player who got elected sheriff. I was 19 years of age, living at home, having a good time. And they probably thought too good a time. So they conspired, they got together and said, I was going to go to work at the sheriff's department when I was 19, and I worked the midnight shift. So that's how I started. Once I got into the profession, kind of appreciated, I always was interested in human services side of it. So, you know, once I got in, I continued my education, worked full time, as I said, got my PhD when I was 28, continued with the state. At the state, we trained police officers. That was our primary responsibility. I worked under the governor's office. We had 8 different academies, including the Chicago Police Academy. So new police officers were hired. It would be our responsibility to train them and to certify in the state of Illinois. What I want to talk about today is, based upon my experience, kind of my perspective on today's policing. As you may gather, as I talk about some of these issues, I am very pro-police because basically that's the profession I've been in. And I've been able to observe people. And while all professions have good and bad, you know, my experience has been most of the people working in law enforcement or public service agencies are good people. So when we think about the American police, they're often lauded as heroes and as often are criticized or incompetent, racist, corrupt, and brutal. And certainly we've had instances of all of these. And what is the true story about the police? Are they all racist, for instance? Are they all corrupt? Given these two divergent characteristics of the police, where do you come down? What's your opinion of the police? Do you have an opinion of the police? When you think of the police, you think good guys, bad guys, somewhere in between. How many have a lot of respect for police officers? How many have an uncomfortableness with police officers? Okay, and why? Because of the power that they have? Basically, power and authority? Definitely, you know, that has something to do with it. And you know, all of us have a certain amount of respect. In other words, we know that they do have certain government powers that are bestowed upon them that give them the opportunity to intervene in our lives. So even myself, if I'm driving down the interstate and I'm going 5 miles over, even if I'm driving the speed limit and I see a state trooper on the side of the road, what am I going to do immediately? I'm going to tap my brakes. It's just that signal, you know, that they have the power. And by their uniforms, by their vehicles, you know, they send that message and it becomes very well understood in society. This was something that was written by August Vollmer, who was basically a person who led the charge to professionalize police. And he said this. He said, "Citizens expect police officers to have the wisdom of Solomon, the courage of David, the strength of Samson, the patience of Job, the leadership of Moses, the kindness of the Good Samaritan, the strategic training of Alexander, the faith of Daniel, the diplomacy of Lincoln, the tolerance of the carpenter of Nazareth, and finally an intimate knowledge of every branch of natural, biological, and social sciences. If he or she had all of these, he or she may be a good police officer." So what do we expect? We expect a lot from police officers. And increasingly, in our profession, we are hiring people with college degrees. That was not always true in the past. For years, we would hire people based upon their political affiliation. The screening was bad, the training was bad, and so we as a profession suffered significantly over that time period. Here's something that's kind of interesting to look at. Gallup poll does a survey every year of most respected professions. And they're consistent from year to year. They usually do it once per year in December. If you look at the professions here and how the general public rates them, from high level of honesty to very low levels on a 5 scale, Likert scale, you see that nurses come in very high, medical people in general, pharmacists, medical doctors, high school teachers, police officers are among the top. Does this surprise anybody? And, you know, one of the things that we have to do is constantly remind officers of this fact. Because what officers do on the street is they work with a segment of the population, a very small segment of the population, who does have disrespect for them and who do get into problems. So what we see in law enforcement is we work with the same segment of the population over and over again. When I worked on the midnight shift for 2 years, I basically lost contact with good people. When I'd come in at midnight, that's when bad things happen. The drinking, the drugs, the violence. And I would see that over and over. During the day, I would have to sleep. And so it's a microcosm of the world, basically, that what I'm seeing is not reality. Because if I balanced that out and, you know, saw the good people during the day, then I would have a totally different perspective. So there are certain built-in things in the policing profession that we have to protect our officers about. And one of them is to make sure that they do not become cynical, that they do not focus on certain individuals, believe that certain individuals are responsible for all crime, that dealing with good people, when they have that occasion, that they don't show cynicism toward those good people. And here's just another kind of chart. Nurses, this was in 2006, nurses, pharmacists, medical doctors, again, police officers, near the very top. And one of the things that I want to point out here is that of those people who are surveyed, if you break it down by age or by race, there's not a significant difference. In other words, you know, some might believe, especially with some of the incidents and shootings that we've seen over the last 5-10 years, that by race there would be less respect. And of course, this is a random sample of all citizens, and we don't find that to be the case. We find that minority community, minority respondents do not respond that much differently than do Caucasians. But you can look down the list, and kind of interesting, who's last? Members of Congress, right? And also, if you look, journalists would be fairly low, of course, insurance, car salespeople, advertisers, but this is a significant amount, and it relates to something I'll talk about later. So the police are part of the political system. They have the power granted by the government. They report, operate, and report through a governmental structure, and they're ultimately accountable to the public. Police service delivery in the United States, very fragmented. We have 18,000 police agencies in the United States. So we have, you know, I've worked significantly with Chicago Police Department. Chicago has about 12,000 sworn personnel. But I also worked with departments that averaged 10 or less police officers in very rural areas. So we're fragmented in that sense. A lot of police agencies. There are about 1 million state, local, and federal law enforcement officers. So you can see that the balance, about 800,000, operate at the local level for municipal, county sheriff's departments, those types of positions. So we're unlike other nations in the sense that in a lot of nations, police are centralized at the federal level. In this country, the federal government does not have a lot of influence on policing. They don't pay the budgets. The budgets come from local tax districts, obviously. So we're autonomous in a sense. So two opposing questions. In a democracy, for what purpose do police exist? What is the job of the police? And what most of us would say, it is to protect, to make arrests. So, agency of social control. Obviously, what we've decided as a society is that we need certain individuals that have powers and authorities, a very limited number as well, but we need those people to protect us. With chief value being efficient law enforcement of prohibitive norms and criminal laws. Make arrests. Go after bad people. R is the basic commitment to rule of the law, even if this obligation may result in a reduction of social order. And what do I mean by that? As a police officer, I am told that part of my job is to make arrests. So I have to arrest bad people. You know, if we look at the city of Chicago, for instance, and we'll talk about the gang problems there. Can police officers have an impact on gangs in Chicago? And my answer is absolutely we could. If we didn't have to worry about this second thing, rule of the law, the Constitution, could we go into Chicago, if I had the authority as a leader, I would summon the military, we could go into Chicago and we could get rid of the gangs. I guarantee you, within 2 or 3 days, they would be gone. But that would involve some extraordinary measures. People would get hurt, people would get killed, and we would have to violate constitutional rights. So here's what police are faced with. We want them to reduce crime, to protect us, but they have to do so while observing rule of the law. And so I can think of a situation in Chicago that I was actually on. They had shootings in these high-rises over a several-day period. These squads, there were 6 squad cars, maybe 7, filled up. We went out to the high-rise. These guys went in, started at the top of the building, came, worked their way down, going through every apartment, seizing guns. That was their objective. Did they have a search warrant? This was a few years ago. Did they have a search warrant? No. Why did they do it? They did it because people were getting killed. People were getting shot. So do police sometimes bend the rules to make sure that they achieve this social control? They do, and that's the balance. That's what we have to be careful about. Dual responsibility of law enforcement to make the public safe. We must arrest and confine the criminally dangerous. But to make the public safe, we must also restrain the government from the presumption of guilt and disregard for due process. If I'm a citizen and police are going after, you know, I have kids in, if I had kids in middle school and there are bad guys trying to influence them by selling them drugs, and I know about this, as a parent, do I want the police to go after those guys? Get them out of there, get them off the streets? You're absolutely right, I do. But why do I? Because it doesn't affect me in a certain way because they're my kids. But now, if we open the door and say go after them, forget about their due process rights, get them off the streets, that's fine. And most people, a lot of people would support that. But what happens when it turns on you? That makes a difference. It's all right if it applies to somebody else. But if I got stopped, you know, would I want my due process rights to be protected? So does this dual responsibility present U.S. police with conflicting goals, or are these dual roles part and parcel to policing in a democratic society? What do you think? Are they conflicting goals, but are they necessary that both of these goals exist in combination? How many think that there's some conflict in that? There absolutely is. And that's the key, to keep this balance, to remind police officers. So in retrospect, you know, we developed the curriculum to train police officers, and I was there as director 17 years. When I look back, did we do a good job in the academy of teaching both of these concepts? Sure, we talked about constitutional law, but we also talked a lot about getting the bad guys, how to take people down, how to, you know, use deadly force, all of these things, how to fire weapons. So I'm not sure, even looking back, that we had the right balance there. And then once they get on the street, what happens to them? Once they get in the culture, if I am a police officer and I'm sent into a neighborhood that's a tough neighborhood with gangs, am I going to be the same police officer when I go into that environment as I am 2 years from now? No. It's going to affect me. It's going to change me. It's going to change my perspective. And that's why such things as job rotation are so important. You know, you cannot, they found this out the hard way, you can't bring somebody in, a police officer, and say, you're going to be a gang officer, put them in a gang-infested area and leave them there for years. Because they're going to pick up and mimic and adopt the same subculture that the gangs themselves have. And that means, you know, getting back to this concept of protecting due process versus getting the bad guys off the street. Okay, so what are some of the issues that we constantly deal with in policing? Obviously, public trust and integrity is important. And all you have to do is look how we hire police officers. There's probably not another profession that goes under review in terms of trying to discover whether the person has the character and the ethics. Because we're going to empower them with a lot of powers that ordinary people do not have. They have the right to intervene in the lives of people. The right to use force and deadly force against people if necessary, the right to detain. They have the right and the knowledge of personal information or confidential information. And so as such, the hiring standards have to be extraordinarily high. When you hear about doing background checks, so important. You know, what are we doing with a background check? The best predictor of future integrity and character is to take a look at that person's record over the last 5 years. You know, if we can see that this person's a good person of good character, then we can project that if we hire this person, that behavior is probably going to continue. And then we give background, not only the background checks, but we do psychological examinations. polygraphs. Are these assessments perfect? No, they're not perfect. There's always going to be somebody slip in that should not have been in the profession. So we make mistakes. But what profession does not? You know, if we look at the clergy, you know, we can look at any of those professions that we, nurses, that we hold in high esteem. You know, do we have nurse problems with nurses in terms of integrity and character? You have a lot of, not a lot, you have some nurses who are drug addicts, you know, so you have to worry about theft. You know, so I'm saying, making the point that every profession, you know, has incidents of people who are not ethical or do not live up to the standards of the profession. We talked about government and politics. What we tried to do is separate the police and politics. In other words, but we can never totally separate it because they work for politicians, basically. But years ago, for instance, with civil service now, you know, if a new mayor comes in and he doesn't or she doesn't like me, you know, can they fire me as a police officer? No, I have civil service protection. So I'm protected in that sense from government intervention. You know, I can hold on to my job. So what we've tried to do over the years is separate as much as possible government out of policing. And most city administrators, mayors, you know, hopefully the way they operate is they hire good people as administrators of their police agencies, chiefs, and they hire them for their professionalism. And they get out of the way. They don't manage the day-to-day operations, just like they shouldn't manage the day-to-day operations of the street department or all the other departments within the city. That's the sign of a good manager or a good leader. Of course, we deal with the media constantly, and I'll talk a little bit about that in a minute. But how does the image project the police? My assessment is that, you know, the media has not been real fair to the police. If you look simply at the case of Ferguson, Missouri, when Michael Brown was shot and killed by a white police officer, you know, immediately, only because the officer was white and the person who was killed was a young black man, there were assumptions made by the press, even before all the facts were out. You know, and then later, what we found with that case is, once the internal investigation was done, once the courts reviewed it through a grand jury system, once the FBI investigated any possibility of civil rights violation, what did we find out? We found out that there were no charges against the officer, that it was a justified shooting. You know, so a lot of times the press reacts when they shouldn't be reacting. They start writing stories. Obviously, that's their job to sell. But, and I'm not saying only the press, sometimes politicians do the same thing. And that becomes very dangerous. We have a criminal justice system, basically, that works in the United States most of the time. Are there problems? Absolutely. Myths about policing. You know, is policing what's portrayed on TV? Excitement all the time? I can tell you, a lot of times it's boring. You know, do police do a good job at solving crimes? Police solve about 20% of Part 1 index crimes. 20%. If they're crime fighters, if that's their major mission, they're doing a very poor job. Now, if we talk about different types of crimes, that increases. So if we talk about murders, what percentage of murders do you think are solved? Pardon?
So it depends on where you are.
Okay? Generally.
60%.
Yeah, about 65% are solved. How many burglaries? If you have your apartment burglarized tonight, or your car broke into, and or even stolen, what are the chances of recovery? Very slim. Why? Because police are going to prioritize. Murders, they're going to deploy everybody they have to work on that. If you have a burglary at your apartment, really no big deal, you know, in the scheme of things. And basically, they don't have the resources to provide, to spend, you know, assigning a detective to work your case. you know. So, you know, that's one of the myths about policing. Professionalism. Are we a true profession? Is law enforcement a true profession? The way you distinguish professions is by, you know, and the state regulates professions. You know, they regulate, for instance, if we let's think about medical people, let's think about legal, let's think about accounting. All of these have been regulated for years. What's regulation mean? What's professionalism mean? It means you have a certain standard of education that's required to enter into that profession. Law enforcement has not traditionally been included or should be considered a profession by those standards. We have never required a bachelor's degree to be a police officer. You know, that should be the case. When you looked at the example of the breadth of duties that they perform, you know, you would say, you know, these are people who should be highly trained, who should have good educational backgrounds. That has not been the case. So law enforcement still is struggling with this idea. There's mandatory training now for police. If you're hired, you have to go to the basic police academy and so forth. But I would say it's still not up to the standards of other professions. So that's something. Accountability, we may talk about later. Police are held accountable probably more than any other profession. And I'll show you examples of that. Community, one of the things that law enforcement has learned from the past, in order to solve crime, you have to have a good relationship with the community. In the past, police would say, we are the crime fighters, we have the expertise, we have the information to solve crimes. And now they've learned that they're going to solve more crimes if the community's involved with them. What's that mean? We've all heard of community policing, right? So community policing is about building trust between the police and the public. If the public trusts the police, they're going to share information. What do you need to solve crimes? You need information. And when you think about the citizens, if you can get more people on your side, that is, more of the citizens supporting you, the more apt they are to help you. Compare that to these gang areas. If the police go to these gang areas, you know, and these are, you know, in cities, so people get shot basically on the street around buildings with apartments. The police show up and say, I'm investigating this shooting that just occurred. Did you see anything? What are they going to say? I didn't see anything. Why? Because they don't trust the people in their community, plus there could be retaliation from the gangs. So without that type of information, the police are going to have a very difficult time solving crime. Race and racial profiling. You know, is that still a big issue with police? The broader question, is it an issue in society? And, you know, I would suggest, you know, what police agencies have done over the years is that they've made their departments more representative of the communities they protect. And when I started in policing, you would go to the police academy. What would you see at the police? What would I see at the police academy? I would see white males, all about 6 feet tall and good shape. That's the people in the academy. If I go today, what would I see? I would see a lot of women. You know, size doesn't matter, you know, because back then the thinking was you need big, strong people to go into bars, you know, to go into situations and take control. People of all colors. What police departments need to do is get a balance in terms of representation of the community. What happened in Ferguson? Ferguson was about 90-some percent black community. They had, out of 53 officers, they had 3 black officers. That's a problem, you know, because the people who are policing are whites. And who are they policing? They're policing a minority community. In that case, actually, the minorities are the majority in that community. Deadly force and corruption continues to be a problem. You know, we see that police officers, you know, overextend their authority in certain cases, unfortunately end up shooting people. And we also have a problem with corruption. You know, people can gain a lot, especially in certain neighborhoods. You know, if I'm a police officer, and police officers, by the way, may, you know, depending on the community, make pretty good money. But if I'm a police officer and I'm living on a salary that's kind of fixed, you know, I'm not going to get a big raise. Say that I'm even making $70,000 or $80,000 a year, but I have an opportunity just to look the other way and put $10,000 in my pocket to let a drug deal go down. You know, so there's still those temptations. People, police officers who are dishonest have ways to make money. I know, you know, instances where police officers go in, you know, to check on a person, for instance, or people found dead in their apartments. Police officers who would go in, start going through the jewelry boxes, putting everything in their pocket that they can of any value. Who's going to know that it's missing? You know, somebody came in here, maybe somebody broke in. We don't know where that is. And then technology. You know, technology really impacts policing in a big way today. We have DNA, obviously, advancements. GPS, we can track people. Computer forensics, kind of interesting. You know, anything, you know, more crimes are being solved today by computer forensics. So you're on your computer, you're working all the time. Maybe there's something, you know, that happens, some type of crime. I guarantee you the first thing, especially serious crime, murder, fraud, first place they're going to go is to your computer. They're going to pull that computer and you say, okay, I know the police are coming. They may seize my computer. I'm going to erase everything. It doesn't erase. Believe me, they are going to know everything about you.
Actually, if you get specific programs that erase it, like I know the Department of Defense will literally erase their hard drive 7 times just to make sure that it all gets wiped.
Okay.
Well, it's like a race. You know, it's a race. I would say I would feel comfortable, you know, if we get your computer that we could figure out some type of way to discover most of the information. But it's a race. It's a technological race. You're right about that part of it. But Scott Peterson, who most of you probably don't remember, you know, a case several years ago in California, you know, he had a girlfriend. He also happened to have a wife who was pregnant. His wife and the baby, you know, unborn baby, were found dead, and their bodies dumped in the ocean. The police went in on that case and found that he had been studying the tides, when the tide goes out, when the tide comes in the exact same place where she was found. You know, so police, it's to their advantage now, you know, technology is in a lot of cases where they can solve cases fairly, where they couldn't in the past. They have license plate readers, you know, which are kind of interesting. License plate readers, right now, a police car could be roaming the parking lots, automatically taking information from your plate, downloading it into a system. So if you have any type of warrant against you, when you go out, you may have the police waiting for you. Is that an invasion of privacy? Or if you're driving 60 miles an hour down a two-way street, police officer coming 60 miles an hour this way, you're going this way, they can pick up your license plate, put it into a database, and see if you're wanted for anything. Is that an invasion of your privacy? How many feel uncomfortable about that? Why?
Well, it's a lot of information that they're picking up. If they don't have a reason to suspect that I've done something and they're looking for stuff.
They take your license plate and see if you have a warrant, things like that. If you don't have a warrant.
But if they don't have any reason to suspect that I've done anything, why are they looking at my license plate?
But if you have anyone?
Because it's in the public domain, is the answer. You know, same thing with dogs that sniff for drugs. You know, can they walk by your car, sniff drugs, and get a warrant, a search warrant? Yes.
Okay.
So a lot of these types of things that are available, of course, computers and cars. The other thing, especially with Homeland Security now, is CCTV cameras. Basically means that, you know, when you go to any major city in the United States, you go to any airport, you know, you're being recorded constantly, and your face is fed into a database to check against known terrorists. It's called biometrics. It's reading, you know, the dimensions of your face. You know, so these types of things are very helpful. You go to any major city, New York City, for instance, I guarantee you that you're going to be on, somebody's going to be monitoring you, or some computer system's going to be monitoring you the whole time you're there. I want to make sure I leave some time for discussion. So how do police control crime? Traditional policing is basically patrol. You know, that we go out, we drive around, people see the squad car. Because they see the squad car, you know, it's going to prevent them from committing crime or dissuade them from committing crime. Does traditional patrol work? No. The only thing traditional patrol does is make us feel good that the police are around. They drive through our neighborhoods. Another one that we've experienced and you've heard about is community policing. Does community policing, and we discussed this a little bit previously, it really does work to a certain extent. Get the public involved. If you have the public involved, they're going to trust the police. You're going to solve more crimes. Hotspot policing. What's hotspot policing? Hotspot policing is basically if you have an area that has an increase or a high incidence of crime, you're going to flood that area. You're going to go to the hotspot. You're going to go to basically where the crime is. You're going to deploy personnel to that area. Does that work? It does work. What's the problem with it? You can't keep it up. So you cannot keep that same level because there are going to be other demands in other parts of the city, and you cannot just say, okay, this is the hot spot because there's a lot of drug sales, there's a lot of prostitution, whatever the problem might be, and we're going to have a sustained presence there. It doesn't work. So eventually, initially it'll reduce the crime rate, but it may also displace the crime. In other words, gangs who are operating, selling drugs in that area, the police has a big presence, they may move to other areas where they haven't sold before. And then problem-oriented policing, you know, what this is designed to do is basically to say that police have to be smarter. If we have a situation, let me use an example of the campus area. I know we've had several apartment complexes that include students that are privately owned but close to the university that have some problems with crime. You know, if the police, Murfreesboro police, are called over and over to this one location, this one apartment building, you know, they can track that. We have crime tracking, and they can see that we're getting called to this apartment complex quite often. What problem-oriented policing would say, go into that area and find out why crime's occurring there. Problem solving. Sit down with the landlords, run the plates, who is living there, who is around that complex a lot, what's the security measures like there in that, is the landlord doing background checks on people they rent to, what types of crimes are we seeing? People that are arrested there, do they actually live there or not? We can break it all down. The objective is that police do not want to get called back to that same address over and over again. Let's correct the problems so that, you know, we don't have repeat calls. Same thing with domestic violence situations. We know if you tracked with the Murfreesboro Police Department, they would have a number of addresses where they have high incidence of call from police involving probably domestic violence and alcohol involved in the domestic dispute. They have most of the houses where they never have responded for a domestic call. So who do they focus on? Problem-oriented policing would say, focus on those properties. Focus on those people, and in this case, get them assistance. make sure Family Services knows about it, make sure that they get counseling. If we have to involve the court, you know, let's do that. Let's fix the problem so we don't have to keep coming back. And then zero tolerance policing was a strategy that was used in New York City with a lot of success. What is zero tolerance policing? Zero tolerance policing, and this was brought in by Mayor Giuliani. Mayor Giuliani, when he ran for mayor of New York City, had been a federal prosecutor. He had dealt with organized crime. He had a tough image, tough on crime image. At that time, New York City had a significant crime problem. He went in and basically he told the police that we're not going to tolerate any type of deviance. Any type of offense that occurs, make an arrest. So if you jaywalk, if you are loitering, if you are drinking in public, arrest that person. The theory being that if we arrest low-level crimes, it's going to send the message that crime is not tolerated, and it's going to prevent them from moving up the ladder to more serious crimes. Did it work? It worked. You know, a lot of emphasis on stop and frisk, getting guns off the street, going after bad people, a very aggressive police presence. But what they learned after a few years was that they were targeting certain segments of the populations, primarily minorities. You know, what they said, we're going to go after anybody. But what did they actually do? They went after people that they suspected were committing these crimes. So there was a real backlash, a lot of citizen complaints, and a court just intervened within the last few years that caused them to moderate and to reduce the numbers of stops and frisks that they've done. So you, again, going back to this concept, can we control crime? We can absolutely control crime. But at what cost? We have to protect individual rights and freedoms. Let me stop there because I think we need to have some questions. So if there are any questions you'd like me to address. Yes?
What are your thoughts about the militarization of the military? I mean, of the
police
force, especially with recently Nashville. Giving all the bulletproof vests for, you know, for like snipers and stuff like that. Is that really necessary for the police to...
Well, you know, what happens a lot of times is that, well, in policing, in society generally, you know, change comes from the outside. Was this a matter of the police sitting down and saying, you know, we want to show a more tough image, you know, more military-like image? We want all this equipment. No, the way that happened was the military had all of this surplus equipment, and the federal government came over and said, hey, you know, cities throughout the nation, do you want these tanks? Do you want this armament? And of course, they say, yeah, you know, that's great. Whether they needed it or not, the federal government's given it away. So, you know, while the federal government, past administration's one who criticized it, they were the ones that brought it about in the first place. I think, you know, but I think the central core, not the militarization, you know, police agencies are paramilitary. Do I think that they could change their image a little bit just by the way they present themselves? I do. Sometimes I think that police want to present themselves as tough and aggressive, and I don't think that's always necessary.
Well, since we're talking about rhetoric, how do you feel we could build a better rapport between citizens who maybe feel disenfranchised from the police and the police themselves?
Okay. You know, again, part of what I plan to talk about, given more time, was that I think that we're focusing on police and we should not be focusing on police. I think that the police are the scapegoats. What are the problems that we're seeing in these major cities? Why did Chicago have 760 murders and 4,000 shootings? You know, The government wants you to believe that that's a police problem, that we have to fix police. Let's get them body cameras. What are body cameras going to do? They're missing the whole problem. My assessment is that what we have to do is we have to rebuild these neighborhoods. These are people who are isolated, who don't have employment opportunities, who are basically shut off from the rest of the society. These are portions of the city that used to be very thriving in terms of industrialization. Industrialization shut down. Those are the exact areas where the gangs are right now. So I think politicians have not lived up to their responsibility to revitalize the cities. We have 15,000 kids, young people of minorities, who have been shot and killed in the inner cities in the last 10 years. And politicians, federal government sits there and does nothing. And I think that's a tragedy. We have to reinvest. These kids have to have something to do. What are they trying to do? Why do they join gangs? They're trying to survive. They want the same things all of us want. They just don't have the opportunity to get there. And so this is an alternative for them. This is how they survive. They sell drugs. They get involved in gang activity, and they're provided for. They have the same things that we can have. But the fact is we're losing too many of these kids. And I use this example. If we had some type of airborne epidemic that was causing 15,000 kids to die, and these kids could die, they could be a senator's son, they could be a governor's daughter, do you think the government would act to stop that virus? But what we are seeing in the inner cities is it's not a crime problem, it's a health epidemic. You know, we're talking about these kids who were shot and killed, and a lot of them, many of them are gang members, but a lot of them aren't. They're caught in this crossfire. The only reason they're in those neighborhoods is because they don't have any way to get out. They were born into families. They were born into poverty. So they don't have any options. And they don't know the options. You know, we would bring these kids down from Chicago to Springfield, capital, where I worked. And I would go out there. And, of course, Illinois is a big livestock state. So we would have all these pigs and cows at the state fair. And these kids would get off the bus from Chicago. And I'll never forget seeing the face on a 13 or 14-year-old kid who had never seen a cow. You know, why haven't they ever seen a cow? They don't know what's out there. They don't know what opportunities they might have. And, you know, what I'm talking about here, you know, I talk about the numbers of deaths, but what about the numbers who are just, who are not just, but who are wounded, you know, who are going to need medical care the rest of their lives from 19 forward, you know? So, and then most importantly, just the lost potential. You know, how could these individuals, if we had a system where they could thrive, you know, how could they contribute to society? We'll never know because they're not given the opportunity. So, you know, I'm very, kind of watch politicians and how they respond. And back to your original question, I think they simply blame the police to distract it from the fact that they've not tried, given much effort to fix the underlying problem that's causing these deaths and the high crime rate.
Earlier in your speech, you said that the disparity between minorities who trust the police and white people who trust the police isn't really that different. Where was that sourced from, and when was it taken?
It was Gallup poll. And you have to remember, you know, what they're doing is they're doing a random sample. So what they're doing by doing a random, if I went into South Los Angeles and took a poll of blacks in terms of their levels of trust, you know, you could predict what that would be. But what I'm saying, if you take it on a nationwide basis, you're taking it from all different levels of economic status. And what I'm saying, when they do that, you don't see much difference in the numbers. Any other questions? Yes?
With regards to Nashville, have you read the Driving While Black report released by Gideon's Army, like, in the last year?
I just heard about it today. We just had a Nashville captain talk to my previous class. Just a short story about racial profiling. When I was in Springfield, of course, you know, I worked in law enforcement, but my office was right across from the Capitol. So I had a lot of interaction, like with the governor's office. I know most the senators, the representatives, for a long period of time. So one of the people that was friends of mine that was in law enforcement, he was a sheriff for years. He then became a senator. So we would talk probably every couple of days. So I went over there one time, and he would be sitting in a committee, and I sat down there. And he says, Tommy said, I want you to introduce, you know, this is a new senator from Chicago. This is the Illinois Senate. And so I met a guy, it's Barack Obama. So I sit in there and I'm talking to Barack Obama. Of course, nobody knew who he was at that point. And kind of the interesting thing that immediately when I met him that I noticed, obviously he's a very bright guy. This sheriff was an old-time sheriff, you know, had high school education, used profanity every sentence, you know, but was a good guy. But I remember Barack Obama just sitting there and laughing at him, and he was the type, you know, you could tell right then that he could relate to all people. He didn't really categorize people. But the thing is, you know, I represented the police. What Barack Obama wanted to do is get something similar to what they had in Nashville, you know, and that is data reporting on racial profiling, and I testified against it. And I told him why I testified against it. I said, why pass legislation for police to collect all this data to prove that we have a problem? Why don't we just admit that there's a problem, that racial profiling occurs, and give us the money to correct it for the training, you know, for awareness, for policy development? But obviously I lost, and he became president, so. Any other questions?
I lived in the city of Chicago for a number of years, and we did have some laws on guns and not having much in them. And now it's, something came out, they said, no, you can't not say there's guns enough. This huge, that was part of the last few years, a huge influx of guns. Is that correct? I'm trying to be calm. I was just...
Well, yeah. You know, you're right. Chicago had the strictest ordinance in the nation on owning of guns. And every year, Chicago police would pull 10,000 guns off the street, illegal guns, which means what? It means that gun control does not work. It means that these guns were coming up from Mississippi, from other states where they could be bought easily, you know, we call them straw buyers. The straw buyers would transport them to Chicago. They would be paid off with drugs. And so, how many favor some form of gun control? Okay. So, you know, the point with Chicago was that even though they had the strictest gun policy, guns got there, you know. And unless we could revoke every gun that's on the street, I'm not sure that any type of gun policy is going to be effective, unfortunately. Yes?
And also with regard to, you were talking about police gathering data on racial profiling. I think the purpose of that is so the public will be aware of exactly what's going on, because, you know, if you're saying that the police are, you know, they are a part of the government because they enforce the laws, and the purpose of the First Amendment is so that the people can hold the government accountable.
Right.
It's important for the people and the press to hold the police accountable as well as the rest of the government.
Yeah, and that absolutely is the theory behind it. But, you know, once all this data was collected, first, then it has to be interpreted, and then the public basically lost interest. So I don't even see stories about it. You mentioned a story in Nashville. I'll have to look about, you know, at that. But, you know, there are so many problems with interpreting the data once it's collected. You know, there are neighborhoods in Chicago that are 98% black. Well, if you're collecting data there, what are you going to see? It's all going to be black, you know, crime. So does that mean the police are targeting by race? No. So there may be other explanations, you know, in terms of what the data you know, the raw data and then interpretation of the data would say.
But Nashville is a very different place from Chicago, though.
It is. But I can guarantee you, unlike most cities, you know, crime occurs in certain neighborhoods. You know, you can go to any city in the United States, and, you know, now with crime tracking, police do that. And you can break it down by neighborhood. So when we talk about Chicago, is Chicago a terrible city? Absolutely not. Chicago is a beautiful, gorgeous city. But are there segments, neighborhoods within Chicago that are very dangerous? Absolutely. So, you know, it has to be broken down into where the crime is actually occurring.
So I think a lot of the issues that some neighborhoods are being monitored more closely than others in Nashville. And there might be crime that's happening about the same scale in other neighborhoods, but we aren't monitoring those neighborhoods as much because if you live there, we think, like, rich white people.
Yeah. You know, again, we would have to take a look at the specific community and the elements or the components involved. You know, if that community is primarily black, but they're also, that's a community that has the highest crime rate, why are the police there? Are they there because of race, or are they there to protect innocent people against crime?
But are the crime rates really higher, though? That's the question, especially with Nashville, which is where they were saying, the report was saying the crime rates weren't necessarily higher than the community
was
being monitored more closely.
Okay. Yeah, I'm going to have to take a look at the report. Thanks for bringing it up.
Thanks for your presentation.
Okay, thank you.